first when I was younger. A strange connection to the light. I tried to satisfy the hunger. I never got it right. I never got it right. So I climbed a mountain, built an altar. Looked out as far as I could see. And every day I'm getting older. I'm running out of dreams. I'm running out of dreams. But your love.
Fellowship, how y'all doing? I had coffee. I hope y'all did too. But I had something even better at 8:30, and that was the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It was absolutely sick in this place. It was awesome. And I got to tell you that the Holy Spirit is in this place right now. Do you believe that? I hope so. It's an awesome day. It's a gorgeous weather. How many people love this weather? It's awesome. You get to warm up. And some of you are thanking God for heaters and all that good stuff and sweaters. So it's a gorgeous day. I just have this big old smile on my face. So let's pray, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for loving us. We thank you so much for welcoming us into your presence. Lord, we thank you that you invite us in. And Father, we just pray right now that your Holy Spirit may just fill this place. And those that are watching online, may you fill that room that they're at. Lord, we just pray that you may bring us together in the unity of your Spirit as we raise our voice, as we clap our hands, as we exalt your name. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you show up and meet us at our time of need and our moments where we just need to see and feel you and hear you. So God, we thank you for this day, for this is a day that you've made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We love you in Jesus' precious and awesome name. And we all say amen. Let's all rise and let's worship the Lord. Amen. Come on, put your hands together.
Open the heavens, oh Lord. Pour out your spirit.
morning start at 10:30, amen? Give him praise, he's worthy, he's worthy. I don't know how many in this room had an opportunity to serve at the at last week's Thanksgiving Sunday supper. If you were there, you were able to see so many faces smiling as we were able to bless them and just really share the love of the Lord either through prayer, through a smile, through food. I mean, it was absolutely awesome. We had thousands of people showing up, and it was actually absolutely a blessing. For those that were there, thank you for being a blessing to many. And for those that weren't there, don't miss next year. I got to tell you, it is a blessing to be a blessing. It really is. And there was a song that we did that the choir was there. And as we started doing this, there was this hush. And everybody just started joining in. And it was so awesome that when I looked over my left shoulder, I just saw people with their hands raised, veterans, homeless, families. And it was an eruption of just thanksgiving to the Lord and blessing him. And we all sang this song. So as we sing this, I just pray that spirit of thanksgiving as we get ready to enter into the season of Christmas, that it may not be a seasonal thing, but it may be an every single day, 24/7, amen? Just of giving thanks to the Lord and saying that you're awesome, that you are so good, amen? So as we raise our voice, just join with us and sing. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Lift your voice and say.
Sing like never before. Oh my soul. Worship your holy name.
Oh.
when my strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise.
If you find yourself in this place this morning and you're going through some hard times where you think that school of hard knocks is kicking you down, I got to tell you that the Spirit of the Lord is in this place and He wants the Spirit of freedom to just reign in your life this morning. So as we sing this one more time, if you got anything to let go and just let God move, it could be absolutely anything. Prayer of our heart is that when we sing, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name, that we can lift our voice, raise our hands up in victory, because He has given us the victory this morning. Amen? Amen? So could you join just one more time, and with all your heart, raise your voice and say, bless the Lord, O my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Say, sing like never,
sing like never before. Oh my soul, worship Your holy name. I'm gonna worship Your holy name. Oh Lord, I'm gonna worship, worship Your holy name.
Thank you, Jesus. As we continue to worship the Lord, if you'd like to remain standing or have a seat, we're just gonna continue in this spirit of worship and just praise the Lord. Amen.
Power in the moon.
Presence of your Holy Spirit, that we can see your face. Lord, we thank you that we know that you are in this place right now. And you're speaking to our heart. En la presencia de Dios se quita todo dolor. Podemos ver tu rostro. In the presence of your Spirit, all pain is gone, that we can see your face, Lord. And Heavenly Father, we just come before you and we say that you are beautiful. Thank you for your never failing, never ending love. Lord, we thank you for who you are. And Heavenly Father, as we get ready to listen to your message, to your word, Heavenly Father, we just pray for your anointing to just be all over every vowel, every syllable, every word that is spoken. Heavenly Father, we pray for your anointing from the top of our pastor's head to the bottom of his feet. Heavenly Father, we just pray that every word spoken may land on every heart, that it may not just be heard, but that it may penetrate, that it may pierce every heart. Heavenly Father, we've come into your place and we've given you our praise. We've raised our voices. We've shouted your praises. And Lord, we just say that you are beautiful. And we thank you for loving us so much. Could you just sing this one more time with us and say, I see your face, you're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. Say that to the Lord.
I see your face. You're beautiful. You're beautiful. You're beautiful.
Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and may your glory fill this earth. We love you. We give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor in Jesus' precious name. All God's family said, would y'all give him some praise, for he is worthy. Oh, come on, give him some praise. You may be seated.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Name above all names. Blessed Redeemer.
Time. Oh, come on, you got like 10:30 coffee going in there. I'm like vibrating here. God is good. And all the time. Hey, I spoke about this just a few seconds ago. If you were there at the Thanksgiving Sunday supper, it was absolutely a phenomenal thing. And it was an amazing experience. If you would do me a huge favor, and in your programs, if you would pull out the Blessed to be a Blessing flyer. We've been talking about this for a few weeks now, about a month now, and it is that time of the year where we bring a love offering unto the Lord. In the Bible, they did that at the end of the year. They just came and said, you know what, Lord, you blessed me from here to here, and I just want to give back unto you what you're pouring into my heart to do. So we're going to do that this year, and we've been doing this every single year. And what we're asking is for you to just take a knee or take two knees and just ask the Lord and pray about it and say, God, you've helped me between this time and this time, and you have just been my provider, and I just want to give back unto you what I am being led by your spirit. So what's happening is, as you saw there, and I got to tell you, how many saw that little kid with the ice skates? All the moms were getting ready to go, aw, because it was so cute as he was picking up the little kid, right? So what we're doing is this year, the Blessed to Be a Blessing campaign is going to help continue our kids ministry program so that we can further serve them and as well help the community and get the children to come unto the Lord and get to know the Lord more. Amen? Amen? Whitney Houston did a song, I believe, Children Are Our Future. I know all the women, that you all have sung that song before. So if the children of today are the leaders of tomorrow, then how much better would it be for those children of today to be grounded in the truth and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? So all the proceeds are going to be going to further the kingdom and just to continue pouring into the lives of our children through our Kids World ministry and to outreach for the communities for the children as well. So we have a family that has stepped up and they said, you know what? We are going to match anything that is received up to $30,000. We will do a one-time match. So just absolutely praise it up, praise it up. And if you are led by the Holy Spirit, anybody who would like to contribute $1,000 or more, there is a legacy wall. If you walk out those doors and make a sharp right, it's a beautiful wall, and it's a legacy wall. And the first time they did that, there were hundreds of names that were put on that wall. And I got to tell you, there's room for 100, 200, 300 more names. So if you're led by the Holy Spirit, any gift of $1,000 or more will go on that legacy wall as a way of saying thank you for the furthering of the kingdom and the hastening of the day of thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Amen. Amen. If you're new to New Venture, do me a favor while you listen to my raspy voice. Could you please pull out the little connection card that's in your program as well? And if you have a pen, as I'm speaking, would you do me a favor and write down some information? It's asking for your name, phone number, and all that. And if you are in need of anything, prayer or anything like that, flip it on the backside. What we like to do is we like to serve our members. We like to serve the people. We love to really serve everybody that's here that walks through these doors. And we are a serving church, I got to tell you. So if you are wondering how we get to serve you, well, it's either you need some counseling, if you need some prayer, we got some pastors here on staff that just love to meet with people and pray over you. If you need some counseling, if you need to plug into a ministry, we got some killer ministries. We got a youth program that is absolutely out of this world. They did bubble soccer yesterday. How cool is that? Absolutely insane. So we're all youth, so next time they do that, we all got to go over there and put on a bubble suit, amen? So we get to plug in if you want to serve in any ministry. We have ministries to plug you in. If you want to get involved in a small group, we have small groups as well. And the best thing about it is, I've said this every single week, when I make that right hand turn on Maestra and I see the building and I see the palm trees and whatnot, I just take a deep breath and I say, I am home. So hopefully when you see the place, when you see New Venture, you get to say the same thing, I am home. And if you're new to New Venture, we hope that you call this place home as well. If you're new, hold on to that card. Go outside. We have a connections table. We want to welcome you. We have a gift for first time, second, or third time visitors. And it's our way of saying thank you for stopping by. We hope we can see you every single week as well. Amen? So y'all ready for some word? Are you ready for some word? Let's see this. You guys ready for some word? Y'all ready for some word? Right on, right on. Center, please. Are you guys ready? Right on. Woo, they got it. So why don't we all rise real quick. If you see 2 to 3 people next to you, say hello. If you see some people across the aisles that are new, go and welcome them and say hello. And we're going to get into some word in a few seconds. God bless.
Come for us all, every heart. Good morning. Oh, man. Now, welcome all the people that are watching online, can we, everybody? Come on, a little better than that. Great, great. That's for you. Oh, man. What a great spirit in the church today. How many had an absolutely outrageous, terrific Thanksgiving? Can I see your hands? Oh, good. Fantastic. Great. Last night in our service, we had a very large service last night, and many of the people, we had them take 45 seconds to get up, meet somebody new, introduce themselves, and share what was one of the most significant things that stood out for Thanksgiving. We're not going to do that this morning, but it was so neat to see that, that it was a very, very special day for many, and there is such a great spirit in God's house today. I am glad to be in the house of the Lord with you guys, and we made it through another Thanksgiving. Let's thank the Lord together, can we, this morning? Great, great. Oh, man. Well, also, if you're visiting, maybe you're from out of town and you're joining us this morning, we are glad that you've come. Also, you see our series we've been looking at, Say So. We're going to be looking at the chapter that talks about that. It is a chapter that deals with Thanksgiving, and I believe in our few moments this morning, God's got some good stuff for us today. So hold your Bibles up today. I know you're packing word. Oh, man, you should see all the smartphones from my vantage point that are just lit up. And iPads and everything. Open them with me, please. Go with me. We're going to be looking at the book of Psalms. And please turn with me to the 107th this morning. And they've asked me to take my jacket off because of I think there's lines in it that's causing a shimmer or something. But it has been, after the kind of hot summer we've had, isn't the chill in the air kind of cool? Man, it is just really, really so neat. Together, as we are looking at this, we are in the book of Psalms for a few moments. You can download the notes. And as we talk about Thanksgiving together, you know, everyone, for different reasons, are speaking about it. And, you know, it's interesting. I found a couple of things. One was a scientific study that was done, which talks about not only Thanksgiving one day out of the year, but a spirit of thanks living, when we are consistently just grateful for the things that we receive in our lives. Notice these really, really quick. You might be aware of them. We did a series on emotions, and some of these were listed here, but I found it very, very fascinating. They say that the benefits of gratitude, scientifically, they've done research now, and they say this, that gratitude opens the door to more relationships. That they find people that are just more courteous, more gracious, more cordial. It's tend to develop relationships. That's a big deal. Another one is that it improves your physical health. You know, we are finding that people not only who have a more thankful, optimistic, positive heart are not only happier, they are finding that they are healthier. We release certain toxins when we feel more positive about things. And what happens is that has a great impact in a positive way. Another one here, it improves your psychological health. There is less envy, resentment, frustration, anger, and revenge if you are more of a positive person. Hey, guys, get it? Now, most of us are aware of that, but when we understand that thousands of years before the American Medical Association, Moses spoke about this. Nehemiah spoke about this. David spoke about it, particularly in the Psalms together. Also, not only your physical health, not only improves your psychological health, but gratitude enhances empathy and it reduces aggression. You find yourself a decreased desire to get revenge on other people when folks tend to find themselves much more thankful. And that new venture, is there a lot to be grateful for? There is no doubt. I mean, if you ever think, man, things are so bad, there's a target on my back. Please, well, no. There are tens of millions who have it worse than you and worse than me. Man, it is amazing when you put it in perspective. Another one they found out, that grateful people just sleep better. Man, if there's any reason to be more positive, it's better sleep. They talk about releasing melatonin, serotonin, comes from the brain, it courses through the body, it allows for greater sleep if you find yourself with more gratitude. It improves your self-esteem, which is interesting. You're able to appreciate other people, their accomplishments. Not only do you make people feel better, you then in turn feel better about yourself, and it increases mental strength. And I wish we could go through these in detail, but man, when folks came back from the Vietnam War, you know, we lost 58,000 Americans in that war. It was a very, very difficult war, and we came back in those days to a country that wasn't considering those who served in other lands, heroes or protectors of our nation, and it was tough. But they found that the individuals who fought in that war, even though they came back to an environment that wasn't too positive towards them for serving over there, if they had a positive spirit, an optimistic, grateful heart, they did not encounter that post-traumatic syndrome of depression and stress like other people did. So what is interesting we're going to see today, that what science finds out, the Bible spoke about thousands of years before it, and we were able to understand why. In fact, we're going to see that gratitude and thankfulness, the Bible says it's not automatic, but it can be developed. And you know what's interesting? They took the United States, we'll look at this and then dive into God's word. They took the whole U.S. and they said, what are people this Thanksgiving most thankful for regionally? Not personally, but regionally. You'll see the map on the screen. As you see that, notice how regions break up here. I mean, down here you've got the Southwest where you and I live. What do you think the number one thing that folks in this part of the country are most thankful for today? Rain. You know, I mean, we have so little of it. Rain is the big deal. That runs all the way down in this area. And then what happens is if you go to the Midwest, like right over in this area here, they took this survey in the spring and summer, just this past one, and they found that in the Midwest, folks are most thankful for thunderstorms. Because in the summer, it is hot. It is also drought in those areas as well. Thunderstorms are very, very welcome, appreciated, and folks have a lot of excitement about those things. You go to the east part of our country, the eastern seaboard, and it is the ocean, it is the beach, all the way up in this area here. And you go not too far from that. Let's say you hit New York City. They said in New York, what are New Yorkers most thankful, most grateful for? It was interesting. They could have said a lot of things. They said number one was their small apartments. Because there was so little place to live in New York City, if you've ever been there, that basically in that part of the country, that is what they are most grateful for. And then it's way over on the other side here. You go up north, up our coast. You go to Oregon, and Oregonians, they go, what are you guys most grateful for? Now, they had hundreds of things, but the number one thing they said was yoga. Yoga over in Oregon. Very, very fascinating. You go way down here. And you see, look at Hawaii down there at the bottom. What are Hawaiians most grateful for? Well, they ain't got to worry about the waves. They've got that. But they love rainbows. Rainbows after those showers and the beautiful rainbow that comes. Not only was that over down here in Hawaii, but right up here in Louisiana. Same thing, rainbows in that part of the country. Out of all the things that could have been mentioned, those are the only things. I mean, these are just some of the things that we see down here. California is also YouTube, also over here. You go, is anybody going to mention God? I mean, is anyone going to talk about the Lord? Well, you've got that. One part of the country, you see God's mercy, God's forgiveness, God's word, salvation, the love of God. That is in one part of America. Where do you think that is? The South. The South, and they call that the Bible what? The Bible Belt, basically this sensibly. But you know, what is interesting, if they would have asked individuals nationwide, the God we've come to worship today is the one I am most grateful for. And not only me, but across the country. But regionally, they've come up with this. What we are about ready to read in Scripture, God is going to address the North and the South and the east and the west. And he's going to speak a word on thankfulness planet-wide throughout the entire globe. It's a great portion of scripture, and it is a psalm of thanksgiving. Read it with me, family. Would you please look at verse 1 here in Psalm 107 and see for a few minutes what God has got for us on this great Thanksgiving weekend Sunday morning. Well, you see how it starts off. The first two words are give what, family? Oh, man, there you got it there. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is what, church? He is good. His love endures forever. And then here's the verse that has been the theme for our whole series. Let the redeemed of the Lord, now in King James and other versions, it says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. But also, as you read here in the New International Version, let the redeemed of the Lord, what, family? Tell their story. Tell your story. And then it says here, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe. And now here's his geographic lesson for the morning. Verse 3. Those he gathered from the lands, from the east and the west, those who are north and also from the south. Some wandered in desert wasteland, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he, what, family? Thank you, Lord. One of many reasons to be grateful this Thanksgiving weekend. Thank you, God, for your deliverance. Thanks for coming through when I had no hope or help, I felt. Thank you for your deliverance from their distress. And then the Bible says he led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give what, church? Yes. Oh, come on, everybody, give what? Yes. Oh, thank you, Lord. Yeah. We get it, God. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for humankind, for he satisfies the thirsty. This God fills the hungry with good things. Some sat in darkness and utter darkness, prisoners suffering in iron chains because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the plans of the Most High. Verse 12. So he subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble. I've got that underlined in my Bible. That's a great lesson for us today. They cried to the Lord in their trouble. He saved them from their distress. He brought them out of darkness, the utter darkness, and he broke away their chains. Let them give what, church? Here it is again. All the stuff God bestows and does on our behalf, let us give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love, his wonderful deeds for humankind, for he breaks down gates of bronze and cuts through the bars of iron. Let's hold there for just a minute. You start reading this, we are already seeing a pattern of the person who's written this chapter. He's speaking a word to you and I about, man, these people find themselves in trouble. These people find themselves in need. These people are looking for rescue. God shows up and does it. And then he says, hey, because of God's goodness to you, give thanks to the Lord. Now, it's interesting. Who can tell me how many psalms there are in the Bible? Great. You're at last service, deacon. 150 psalms in the Bible. You know, these psalms were written beginning about 1,400 years before Jesus came on the scene. The first Psalms came from Moses, and they go all the way. Most of them were written, as you know, by David. And as they continue to go on, Solomon's got a few, like the Proverbs. You've got 1,400 all the way to 400 years before Christ. 1,000 years it took to write everything we see here. There is, you're talking 19, I'm assuming you're talking 1,000 Psalms. Oh, excuse me, you're talking 1,000 years. I got to get there. I'm still digesting turkey. I don't know what's going on here. It took 1,000 years for them to go ahead and get all these great psalms. And out of the 150 psalms, here's what's fascinating. In every one, God being thanked, God being praised is mentioned in each one. And remember, when you read the psalms, there are 10 different types of psalms in scripture. You know, there are psalms we call of individual lament. Lament is kind of a Bible word for the blues. I mean, the blues of the Bible is called lamenting. And lamenting is going, oh man, things are so bad. God, I don't get it. There's a lot of psalms that deal with God, I don't get it. Let me give you an example. If you're taking notes, write down Psalm 43. Psalm 43, verse 1 says this, "Why are you in despair, O my soul? And why are you discouraged within me? Hope in God, yea, I will hope in God." It is a psalm that a guy wakes up and he is depressed. He is bummed. Things aren't working in his way. And he's thinking for a moment and goes, why are you in despair? He's reflecting back, why are you so put off today? Ever been there? You wake up in the morning and there's something kind of heavy in your spirit. You don't remember what it was of the day or the week before. You're thinking, I'm kind of bummed today. What is it? And all it takes is a few moments and you go, oh, that's it. Either that person, that news, that circumstance or situation. That is a psalm, Psalm 43 of lament. Let me give you another one. Write down Psalm 137. Psalm 137, how about put verses 1 through 4. God's people are a long way from Israel. When you read this psalm, they have now been exported, taken to Babylon, 900 miles away by force. Many of their contemporaries have been wiped out, murdered, their kids dashed against boulders, terrible way to die. They've been set aflame, starved, and terribly executed. The ones who survived were dragged off to captivity. They went to Egypt, they went to Persia, and they're in Babylon by the time you get to Psalm 137. And they said, by the rivers of Babylon, you read verse 1, it reads like this, by the rivers of Babylon we sat and we sobbed. And then in verse 4 it says, how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? They're going, God, things are so bad right now. It's so hard to praise you right now. Maybe you've been there. That's what their experience was. That is a psalm of lamenting, a bummer. There's also psalms of praise, individual praising, community praising. There are psalms of thanksgiving. Every psalm has some of the, and there's all sorts of other ones as well. But what is interesting, it is probably the most popular and read book of all the books in the Bible. Because you get a panoramic view of human emotion. Man, you can read psalms and it reads like thanksgiving every day. You read other psalms and it says, man, I am hurt, I'm joyless, I'm in despair. Man, I am suffering depression. You can catch that in the Psalms as well. When you read the Psalms, it's like reading the days. Well, God's reading my mail and yours as well because he captures our emotion. But I want you to notice with me here, please, a few things that stand out which give us reason in spite of our situation to praise him. Notice down here, it talks about different people groups. And if you look on your notes, you'll want to take a note on this or two. First of all, the Bible talks about those who are wanderers and they find themselves in a desolate type of situation or place. We read that in verse 4. And then what happens is we catch this great portion of scripture. Family, look with me at verse 8. What does it say? Let them give thanks to the Lord, for he is, boy, for his unfailing love. Now there's a Hebrew word for this. And the Hebrew word that is used is chesed. Can you guys say it with me? Chesed. Oh man, a little bit stronger. Chesed. Great. If we were in a synagogue this morning, we had Psalm 107 open. We were reading this. By the time you get to verse 8, the Bible says, give thanks to the Lord for his chesed. And that is where, anytime you read in the Bible, the word loving kindness, the goodness of God, anytime you read of, like we read here, his unfailing love, that word is chesed. He said, for no other reason, when you think about the chesed of God, something he never had to do, and he does anyway. He says there is always reason, not only for thanksgiving, but thanks living, an attitude of gratitude because of the love of God. Then notice the second line of that verse 8. He says another key thing here. It says, for his unfailing love, and the Bible says, and his wonderful deeds. Now it's interesting. Wonderful deeds, and some of your versions say wonderful works. Now, there's a Hebrew word for that. It's an easy one to remember. There was an athlete who had this Hebrew name. Anybody remember a soccer player by the name of Pele? You know, that's a Hebrew word. Pele means the wonder works, the wonders of God. Say it with me, Pele. Pele. One more, Pele. Pele. Man, if we were in a synagogue today, they'd be impressed. Pele means the wonders of God. He says, when you begin to think about thanking God, one of his loving kindness, his chesed. Also, when you think about the Pele of God, the wonderful works he's done, there is no way you can be at the birth, anywhere around the birth of a child and not see the Pele of God, the wonderful works of God. You know, I know so many people, they say it doesn't matter if it's a boy or girl, but Lord, please let them be healthy. You can click off 10 fingers, 10 toes, the brain synapses work, the little eyes are beginning to see. That is the Pele of God. And then there's another word that you're going to see in this chapter. The word isn't Pele, but not only the wonders of God, but the miraculous marvels of God. I asked the church last night, how many believe that God still parts Red Seas? Man, I tell you, hands shot up. No doubt. He wants to part seas in your life and mine. How many, if he so desired, could raise the dead back to life? I've seen him raise dead dreams, dead marriages, dead relationships, dead relationships with him back to life. The word isn't Pele. The word is like that casino, Pala. I don't know how they named it that, but the Pala of God is the miracles of Almighty God. Say it with me, Pala. How about Pele? How about Chesed? Those three simple words there, the wonderful works, the miracles, the loving kindness of God, is reason to give thanks to him on this Thanksgiving Sunday. And we read this down here in Scripture, and he's speaking first to wanderers, then he goes to those, the Bible says, as you notice a little bit further, who are in prisoners, and the Bible says that it now gets dark. Their lives are full of darkness, despair, and gloom. Guys, notice that what now we are reading in Scripture is exactly the way in verse 3 he laid out here, from the east to the west, from the north to the south. Those four areas are the same as the experiences of the people he first names. He names the wanderers, and the Bible says there that they are desolate. And you know, you look east from Israel, you've got that great desert where Moses and his folks were there for 40 years. And that sun raises in the east. The desert is east. The sun beats down on that desert and it is bad. He speaks of those who are wandering in the desert. Second of all, he says this. He says there are those who walk in darkness, those who are in gloom and despair. He says they're kind of like prisoners. There's no joy in their life. There's no hope in their life. There's no future that they can look to with excitement. He says God says he comes on their behalf as well. Then he goes on and he talks about the next group, and he mentions with us, if you'll notice, those prisoners. Did you write the word defeated? Defeated there, and then next one, the next section, he says there's those who are just sick, weighed down, no energy, no life, no options, in their own mind, and they've come with the diseases of the world. And then he mentions one more group. Let's run over there real quick. Look at verse 23. In verse 23, he says here, some went out on the sea, and they went in ships. They were merchants on the mighty waters. They saw the works of the Lord. Here's that word again. His Pele in the deep, the wonderful works of God in the seas. For God spoke, and he stirred up a tempest that lifted high the waves. They mounted up to the heavens and went down to the depths. The Bible says in verse 28, then after it got so bad, they cried out to the Lord in their trouble. And then God was on a rescue mission. He brought them out of their distress. He stilled the storm in a whisper. How many have recognized in 2015 at some time God still stops storms today? Oh, man. No. What storm did God stop for you? What did he look at going on in your life and the tear ducts were full and your face and your gut was flushed with concern and God came along? And sometimes we say he doesn't come when we want, but he's always right on time. And God came on your behalf and he stopped the thing like we talked about before. I never forget the Poseidon adventure, and they're on deck, and I think it was New Year's, and it was Leslie Nielsen, I think, in the old movie. He gets those binoculars out, and he looks, and he sees this wave rising up out of the sea, taller than this building, and making its way toward us. Now, that's all make-believe, but it was sure good TV, wasn't it? No. It was a great movie as well. but it's also our reality. Jesus warned us that there would be waves like Poseidon's coming in our direction. We don't know where, how they came up or how they ended up moving towards us. We didn't expect when we got hit, it would hurt the way that it did. And yet I still see when I read Luke chapter 8 and I read Mark chapter 5 that Jesus Christ still stops storms today. Did a wedding this summer, the greatest single moment in my Christian experience was being able to pray and look in the eyes of my namesake, Shawn Jr., and be able to see and bring him in holy matrimony to Eva. And what a moment it was. What a great joy it was. And I remember the scripture we talked about came out of Luke 8. That man right now, you feel very close to God. There's a lot of people excited for you. Heaven is looking down and heaven agrees with this relationship. It was such a thrill. But we recognize when you push off from shore and you start living life, there are times that those storms will kick up that you don't expect. Bottom line, remember who's on board your ship. Amen. That is the key. And that is what God is doing here. He's giving them examples here. And the last one, number four, you and I feel overwhelmed and distressed. Please write in the word distressed. And yet God is there for you and I in the midst of those things which we encounter. So you see what we talked about just a minute ago. We understand that gratitude is something that isn't automatic. It can be developed. It can be enhanced. It was interesting. I was on Thanksgiving. We had our get-together over Lori's family. I'm out here in El Cajon, a lot of people there, and just a wonderful time together. And you know the guy I got to have dinner with was Lori's mom's friend. Great guy. I mean, this guy, he's got energy. He bounces around, walks still on the ball of his toes, even though he's got a cane. The guy said, I'm not going to eat with you tonight. So we sit down, we're eating the turkey and enjoying. This guy is 99 years old. I mean, if you were around this guy, you think, wow, this guy, I mean, I thought, man, Lord, if I could have that guy's energy. Man, this guy's amazing. We're all cheering him on, man, that he can make a century. And you know what got into his life? When he was young, he talks about the fact he was an alcoholic, doing all the wrong things, drinking, carousing, messing up. And he's into that for a few years, and he thought, what am I doing with my life? He stopped that. He's been going to AA meetings for over 60 years. 60 years. He's been sober like 64 years now. And he's a spokesperson for it. He came to Jesus Christ in the midst of his despair. And he speaks about the Lord. We were all together praying over the meal. We sat down and he leaned over and he goes, I like your prayer. And then he wants to talk about why he likes the prayer. And he goes, yeah, I feel pretty good. But man, sometimes I get a little bit tired. But this guy's 99. Man. And I said, Bob, can you tell me what is the secret, do you think, of having a healthy life and loving God and going as long as you have? He said, well, you know, Shauna, I'm not sure. I can tell you one thing. He said, every day of my life, I wake up every day and I make up a list of 10 things I'm thankful for. He says, first I think them up. And he goes, and I write them down. I go, you write them down? He says, yeah, some people like crossword puzzles. I like writing down what I'm thankful for. He goes, I write down 10 things, and then I pray them up to God and tell him thanks for all 10. I said, every day? He says, well, every day. I go, how long have you been doing it? He goes, well, my mind's not working too good. About 16 or 17 years. Oh, man, I felt like I needed to get saved again. This guy was, and I thought, wow, and there's a key to that. We've talked about that God not only wants you healthier, he wants you happier, he wants you holier, and the place to start is what every psalm says, give thanks and praise to Almighty God. Amen? Praise his name. Oh, man. All the things he does, all the things he keeps from us, and notice down here in Scripture as we go on, simply not only does it affect you physically, but would you write down, guys, in your notes that your outlook and disposition will be impacted by your optimism, your positivity, by your thankfulness and your attitude, outlook and disposition. Boy, what we see in Scripture, most of the Bible says, a glad, grateful heart makes a person happy. A broken heart crushes the spirit. The verse above that says a broken spirit dries up the bones. You and I know what bad news, bad experiences do to us, how the negative way it can impact our lives. I asked last night, I asked you today, as the Lord would bring up to mind one of our pastors, Pastor Tony Hook, was out with our youth yesterday, and my goodness, Matt Swisshelm and the team are tearing it up. They had about 80 some odd kids outside playing bubble, check this name out, bubble soccer. Is that a great name? Where was I when they created bubble soccer? They showed me after service yesterday. They've got these great big bubbles that you can see through, different colors, and they're running around kicking a soccer ball, and they're launching themselves into each other. I saw legs up in the air and the bubble down at the bottom. I thought that thing looked like so much fun. Matt wrote me last night, yesterday, and said, man, Pastor, it was terrific. And all these people were coming out having a great time. In fact, if you're a junior high or a teenager, you're sitting in this service, you don't know what you're missing over in Elevate. Man, you've got to experience what is going on there. They're having just a grand, great old time together. And what we were talking about was the difference it makes when we get together with a spirit of gratitude. We are involved in doing things that not only honor God, but give us reason to thank Him. And our outlook, our disposition, will be impacted by how we choose. You know, you and I get so much bad news on a daily basis. I'm gonna win or lose in life, but what I choose to focus on. Get it? That's the same thing with you. Man, I don't hit Fox News or CNN or any news going on in my world until I get the good news of God, which buoys my spirit, gives me my perspective. And somebody once said, if you can bow to God, you can stand up to anything. Amen? Absolutely, no doubt. So your outlook and disposition is impacted by the God we've come to worship today. So not only that, not only do we see our hearts change in health, but also our spiritual vitality and our power. My prayer this morning, we'll walk out of here in the next 15 minutes and go, Lord, you know what? Give me more of an attitude of gratitude. Let it be ongoing, not just something one day out of the year. Because when we start seeing biblically the good things which come from that kind of spirit, here's what I have found. Spiritual vitality and power. Have you guys ever noticed you cannot have gratitude and carry a grudge at the same time? Notice that? When you are positive, when you are grateful, the seed of discouragement can't grow in that kind of mulch. It can't handle that. And what happens is, you can't be, the Bible says this in James, you can't with your tongue be going, oh, praise God, God, I thank you. And then use that same tongue to talk about other people who God's created. Man, there is no way I can talk negatively here and the same thing, oh, but I love you. He says, no. He says, you are either sweet water or you are bitter. He says, you can't get both out of the same thing. Get it? Man, we need to remember that and hone and really understand. Lord, help me with that gratitude. Let me ask you a question. How many have ever heard of the little story about the statue called Ingratitude? Right here? Not in the other service. This was a story really popular years ago. 1800s is when it came out. There's a story about a statue by the name of Ingratitude, 60 feet tall. It was in the center of a city. And the city didn't like it. See, you've got this great big statue called Ingratitude. Hands on its hips, a furrowed brow, negative, nothing good about ingratitude. And in the city, people are, they all, no matter where they look, they saw ingratitude. So in the story, they all took rocks and they all gathered together because they wanted ingratitude out of the city. And so what happens is they go in there throwing rocks at ingratitude, but they could only throw the rocks with one hand because under the other arm was a little statue they each were holding called ingratitude. And the story is simple, but you get it, that nobody likes ingratitude, but often all of us carry it. You got to watch that. I remember when Big Shawn Jr. was just a little fella and raising him and teaching him to do all the fun things and Monday night football and all the important things of life, you know. Oh, man, he'd come, we'd sit down together and just, oh, man, it was just so many wonderful experiences. But you know, one thing that Lori and I really appreciated was when the Lord gave us an opportunity to bless him. I mean, maybe it was something he'd wanted or had prayed for. And now, we didn't give him everything, of course, but when there was a need, and we were able to meet that need, it thrilled our hearts. We knew we were doing the right thing, and we knew the little guy was going to be happy. You know what made us happy? When he took a moment to say thank you. I mean, you don't do it as a parent for the thank you, but when you hear it, man, you're looking for something else to do for the little guy. Amen? It was something that when it got to a point, if there ever was a time that we were doing anything and there was ingratitude, it was a bummer. Can I say this? Genesis 1:26 says, we were made in the image of God. God's the same way as you and I are as parents. You don't do it for the thank you, but when you take a moment, stop and go, thanks, God. I praise you today. Man, I love you. Thank you for all you've done. When there is, hey, say so. With gratitude, with thanks, it means more to him. And we're going to see as we wrap up our time this morning, it impacts other people. You want to say so, there is power that a grateful heart has that a person who doesn't will never experience the impact you can have on other lives just by being more grateful. Write this down in your notes as we wrap up here. On page 2, there's 5 things it does for us. Number 1, when you are grateful, I kind of alluded to it, the first thing that happens is you honor God. God is honored when you and I express that kind of gratitude. You know what it's saying? How do you honor God? Through a grateful heart. I thank you that your wisdom is greater than mine. God, I want to thank you. You know what's best for me. You know even more than I what is best for me. God, I want to thank you for this situation. I don't like it. It doesn't feel good, but I do love you. And today I want to thank you in spite of what is going on in my life. Man, I saw this thing yesterday that kind of rocked me a little bit. I think it was yesterday from Chula Vista, 2 sweet little sisters. I think they were early teens or something. Did you see that article? Some of you did. They both lost their lives in some terrible traffic accident. And I didn't read the article, but 2 sweet little girls, glasses, and they're just best of friends. And they were both in the car together, and something happened. Now, there is no way you are going to be grateful, thankful, or positive about a tragedy like that or many other ones. This is why I'm glad the Bible says, in everything, I can give thanks. You know why I like it? Because it doesn't say, for everything, give thanks. There are some things that God doesn't give thanks to. We wouldn't expect us to be thankful for it, but we can be thankful through it as we're focusing on him. Amen? You'll know you're on the road to spiritual maturity, that no matter how bad it gets, you can still have a spirit that says, but God. But God. That was Job's heart. Hey, even if God slays me, I'm going to trust in him. I mean, a spirit that says through it all. You know, and then in this, a grateful heart is a heart that honors God. Number 2, you'll notice that a grateful heart, this is interesting, it creates fellowship. You know, what do you mean by that? What I'm trying to say is if you want to be closer to people, the Bible says there's one way you do it. Be more grateful. When you are more grateful, people have a tendency to want to be around you a little bit more. Here's how the Bible puts it. If you want to have a friend, you've got to just show yourself friendly. When you are more positive, when you are more open, what happens is it is a natural attractor. You're new on a job, and somebody shows you the ropes and kind of shares with you, hey, no, you might want to do it this way. A simple, hey, appreciate that. Thanks so much. You know, they're telling us that what happens is people are more keyed in to people who just throw out a thank you is cordial, that basically is more positive. It rubs off. This attitude, this gratitude spirit is one that builds stronger relationships. Number 3, you might want to write it down, and this is key. You know, you want to grow in your faith. Would you write down that a grateful heart, being thankful, develops my faith? Develops my faith. You see those verses there in the scripture? And when you and I can thank God when life stinks, you go, oh my gosh, this is tough. When you can do that, that allows spiritual growth to happen in your life. You know, God has promised to see me through life's most difficult situations. And when I am grateful to him, in times when I'm not grateful for it, but God help me to be grateful through it. Faith is deepened. Get it? Amen. It's an amazing thing. And God, many of you know, if whether you are a walker, a biker, a runner, you work out, whatever it is, it takes consistency to start seeing the results you're looking for. It's the same way spiritually. You go, Lord, I hear this. Now, please help me day after day. Help me to apply this. And as you do that, then you start seeing this spiritual development taking place in your life and mine. And you know the best way to serve others is through gratitude. Would you write down serve others? When I am grateful, it's the best way to be of service to other people. In fact, I like to call it this, a ministry of appreciation. And I'm so honored. There's a lot of that going on around our church here. There's just many people that go around and look for ways to give a fist bump, a high five, a pat on the back, and to encourage that ministry of appreciation. You know, you guys all know how this works. You get a brand new car. You go to a place, you buy a car. The minute you drive off the lot, what happens to that car? It depreciates. I mean, it can look sweet and be fantastic. By the time they pull that sticker off and you pull out and it smells good, the moment it drops in value. You know, we know depreciation. Appreciation does the opposite. It raises in value. I encourage folks last service. Family, you know what you might want to do? Is use within the next 3 or 4 weeks, drop a text, an email, or make a phone call to your small group leaders, to your leaders, and just appreciate them. Speak a word of, hey, thanks for a year of trying so hard to feed me the Word of God. Thanks for making the home so comfortable. Thanks for checking up on me when I wasn't in small group. That simple act of just, hey, just checking in, or hey, appreciate you, or hey, thank you, creates a sense of appreciation and is a wonderful way to serve other people. Get it? Do that. Let God bless you and bless them at the same time. And the last one this morning, we say so with thanks. Probably the best example of that is the best way, you know, when I am grateful, it is a witness to others. It's a witness. Saying so impacts. The best way to share your faith is with that spirit of gratitude. You know, we are to live our lives in a way that makes the truth of God more attractive, that makes His church more appealing to folks that are looking for something, that makes your home a place where they'd go, I know I can always talk to her or to him because there's something different about them and they're positive. God has given us 150 psalms, and he continues to emphasize, give thanks, be grateful. Man, I close with this. I was grateful years ago, before we started ministry here. There was a ministry of the church I was at, Horizon Christian Fellowship, and also working for Dr. Billy Graham, was doing ministry around the world, going to countries all over the world, sharing the love of Jesus, taking teams from America across the ocean and being on the streets and sharing the Lord. It was a great time. I remember I was in Scotland. I was on my 7th trip to Scotland doing ministry. They'd asked me to speak at various churches there, and I was picked up at the airport by a gentleman, older minister, great guy. We got in his car, and we're driving back through the boroughs of his place called Edinburgh. If you've ever been to Edinburgh, Scotland, just like in the movies. I mean, you've got the hills are green. There's big fat sheep on the hillside. It's like, man, this is like a movie or something, or National Geographic. We drove through the streets, and finally, after about a half hour from the airport, we get to where his house is. Right across from his house is this church. Church's got this great big steeple. The top of the steeple is a cross. And we went in, had a cup of tea before calling it a night, had to preach there the next morning, got up really early, spent time with the Lord, put on the gym stuff to go out for an early morning run. Wanted to be in Scotland running, and I went out and took off, and I just loved it. Running with the Lord, feeling the cold air on your face, and praying to Him, and watching the sunrise in that part of the world. Anyway, ran and ran and ran. I think I ran too long, actually. I don't know. It was a few miles, not that many. But I went through boroughs, streets, alleys. Finally, I got to a point of thinking, man, I gotta get back. Well, by the time I stopped and I looked back to go back to where the house was, guys, I couldn't see where to go to save my life. Two words, I was lost. I say three words, I was big time. I thought, well, I was nervous. I'm about 7,000 miles from my house in Oceanside, and I'm thinking, where did that guy live? I'm looking one way and the other. I start running back down this street and going, not that it wasn't familiar. I'd run back. I'd go another way, and I'd pray, and Lord, please, I got to get back. And then a thought came to my mind. The night before when we drove from the airport to the house, as we drove through there to his place, he said, there's the church you'll be at tomorrow with a big steeple and stuff. I thought that big cross at the top. So I'm looking down, and I mean, you could see, look like hundreds and hundreds of homes, just like little things all over the place. And through all of these homes, way out in the distance, I saw that church. Now it looks about this big, and at the top is this steeple, and at the top I see the cross of Jesus Christ. I thought, I got it. So I went, started running, and every time after running for a while, I would look up for the cross. You know what I found out that day? That if you can find the cross, you can make your way home. Amen. Isn't that right? Oh, just get me to the cross, and I'm going to be all right. And that is the same thing with you. When we find our way to the cross, all that we want is found there. And his three words, Jesus, it is finished. Because of what he did, that's going to be a good Thanksgiving Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday next week. And a good 2016, get to the cross, families. Get to the cross, individual. You'll be all right. Can we give him praise this Thanksgiving Sunday? Do you love him? Hey, why don't you thank him like you mean it? Oh, thank you. Praise the Lord. Bow your heads with me, would you, family? Father, we thank you for our morning. We thank you for our online family, our family by radio today. And Father, we most of all thank you that we are united in one name, Jesus Christ. Lord, we love Jesus this morning. We thank you for that name. We are crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, we live. And the life which we now live in the flesh, we live by faith in the Son of God, who died and gave himself for us. Father, we want to thank you for your care and goodness and love and passion for us. Your passion, which meets us daily. You want what's best for us. And like your kids, you want us to remember, to come back, and to say thank you. We thank you for the kabod of God. Lord, your loving kindness that is so undeserved. Father, last service we asked how many are grateful for mercy, and hands and voices were just raised. Lord, thank you for mercy, not getting what we do deserve. Lord, we thank you for your grace today. Grace is you giving us what we don't deserve. Thank you for what you give us and what you hold from us. Oh, I thank you for this side of eternity, because we get a chance to get to know you better. I want to pray for every young family that is here today, that God, I would ask, I claim Ecclesiastes chapter 4, that you would be between each couple represented in this room today. That, Lord, you say two are better than one, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. That third cord we know is you, united in you. Lord, I pray for every individual here today. God, we thank you that the number one lover of our lives, bar none, is you. You put up with us. You believe the best in us. You forgive our sins and our iniquities, but you don't allow us just to remain comfortable in them. You take us to a better place. Lord, today, man, we figuratively fist bump and high five and hug you for your love for us. Help us to say so, first to you in thanks, and then to others in the goodness you bring into each one of our lives today. I pray for those who are with us through technology, that they feel the same Holy Spirit we feel in here today. And I would pray, God, whisper to us, move on our lives over the course of this week. As we now begin to hear Christmas carols, I love how often, Jesus, your name is mentioned. Thank you. They are singing your songs. Thank you. We know the one they're singing about. With every head bowed this morning, who showed up today and they're thinking, man, I've never heard God talked about like this, and these guys are into it. It's not because we're so great. It's because he's a great God, and he wants you to know him. That's why he sent his son. In fact, he said this. Jesus said, if you were to come to him, he would in no way turn his back to you. He would in no way cast you out. He said, but if you confess the things you've done wrong, and all of us have done many, but specifically he says sin, he'll forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Man, what a bargain. What an amazing grace. How many here want to go to heaven one day? Not today, maybe not the next few decades, but one day when it's time to check out, you want to know that you've checked in and you are forever with him. And you're going, Lord, would you remember me? Whenever that day comes, I want to be with you forever. If that's your heart, hand up and back down. Yes, yes, saying yes, 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 yes. Great, good, good. Who else this morning is going, man, yes, good. Say, man, I want to be sure. Not playing games, not religion, but a relationship. I want God in my life. And those online, make the decision that is being made by folks all over this church this morning. Man, when the best thing you can do to this Heavenly Father is come home. He wants you to come home, and he loves you. Do that now and join these. With heads bowed, hands that went up, pray this prayer. Forget who's sitting next to you, pray this. God, thank you that I live to see another Thanksgiving weekend. Tell him that. I know that every breath is from you. Thank you. And thank you for sending Jesus for me. Tell him that. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus, for me. Forgive me of sin, please, God. I know that's living a life apart from you, trying to do it all on my own, and I'm sorry, I've kind of botched it up. That's why I want Jesus today. Did you tell him that? That's why I want Jesus today. Please come into my heart right now. I want you. I want you, Lord. I want to be a born-again follower and mean it. So I receive you now by faith. Help me walk the talk. Make me strong in you. And make me grateful. And Father, please use New Venture to help these friends grow in their walk, to get a hold of the Word of God, the Bible, and recognize that living begins right now. We love you, Lord. Thanks for a happy Thanksgiving. Thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Man. Hope you find some time today just to get alone with him. Tell him how much he means to you. It'll make him feel wonderful. It'll do so boomerang back to you as well. For those who made decisions today around his church, we are excited for you. We know you meant it. You probably heard it, felt a tap on your shoulder. Those are our deacons. They are just handing you stuff to help you grow in your relationship with the Lord. Man, truly, life is just starting. And here's what you might want to do. When we dismiss in the next few minutes, up here will be lined with women and men who spend a good portion of their week praying for the 10:30 service when it's over, that they get a chance to pray for you. because everyone up here has also been in need of prayer, so they get it. And so if it's you this morning, come on down front, give us a few moments. We are thrilled for you. And we'll wait. When you go outside, there's going to be food out there, the cafe presenting food outside. There'll be live music outside. You'll meet a lot of wonderful people. If you're a visitor, we call it the guest center. Man, we want you to feel like family. So there's these, Pastor James did a great job of sharing with you. You just go right out there with your card and say, hey, it's my first time, or second or third. 1 through 3, there's a gift for you. Be sure. It's our way of saying thanks for coming. And I'm telling you what, it is just great to know a Mendon family. Can we together one more time, one last time this morning, let's thank God for his goodness today. Next week is Blessed to Be a Blessing. They did it in the Old Testament. We do it here at New Venture. Above our tithes, once a year, we bring a special gratitude gift to God. And we say, God, thank you for 2015. I'm trusting you for the next year. And this is just a thank you because I love you. We got families and individuals, our children, our teenagers, bringing a special gratitude gift. All the monies this year go towards our children, our kids' programming. Now we got to put in things like sprinkler systems and stuff to make sure we comply and all and things like that. So for our kids here and in the community, bring it next week or anytime during December. But right now, before we go, we get to give our tithes and offerings to God this morning. We get to say, God, thank you for your goodness to us. And so we're going to ask you to stay seated, please. We're going to pray real fast and our host will come. Let's talk to the Lord. Father, thanks for your goodness. Thank you, God, for the day that's ahead. And thank you that we don't have to go into it without you. Lord, bless our tithes and our offerings now. It is amazing to us that we can bless and bring delight to your heart. Receive that today. In Jesus' name, amen. Host will come.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Lord, we thank you for meeting us in this place. Lord, as we leave this place right now, we thank you that we don't leave your presence, that you go with us, Lord. And so as we go outside and have fellowship and continue loving each other and just really establishing great friendships and family, Lord, Father, we just pray that we could rejoice in such a beautiful day that you've blessed us with. And as we go home and spend time with our families, our loved ones, Lord, wherever we go this week, Lord, we just want to be able to be that billboard just proclaiming who you are and just raising your name even higher and higher. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And Lord, we just thank you for the honor and the privilege of being together as a family, raising your name higher and higher.
Lord, we thank you. We give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' precious name, all God's family said. Hey, Pastor Sean's going to be in the back shaking some hands. You're more than welcome to stick around. We're going to continue with some worship. Amen. If you're new to New Venture, please stop by our connections table and welcome home. Amen. So we're going to do some more worship. Amen. Here we go.
To extend Jesus' name, glory.
go outside and have some fellowship. We'll see you next week. God bless everybody.